Book Group with Mary. Through the Mists by Robert James Leeds. This is Chapter 12, Session 1, 10th of October 2012, Wondai, Queensland, Australia.
Hi everyone, welcome to Chapter 12. How are you all going today? Too bad. That's good. We're good to go, everyone. Okay, let's talk about the book. How do you guys feel about this chapter? Short and punchy. Sometimes I look at them and I go, oh, this one's only like 3-4 pages. We'll just whip through this, and then I start reading and go, oh, we could need 2 sessions anyway. What's the major thing that struck you about this chapter? Who wants to start? Deirdre?
I got the mic.
Yeah.
How even though when Fred went over and he got used to his surroundings, he couldn't see Earth the way he used to see it when he was on Earth. And yet, from what I can tell, not much time has passed.
No.
And I found that, whoa.
Yeah.
I really shouldn't be so hard on myself.
Well, but we need to talk about why that's the case. Because why do you think that he found it hard to see?
I kind of know. I don't know. Just from what I know what Kushner said, but why he couldn't, I don't know. Maybe the same reason why I can't see.
Well, yeah.
Like, I'm afraid. Like, I did have one spirit talk to me, like, just, like, right there. And I did see one, and I was just paralysed with fear because what is it? Like, what's going on?
Okay, so we need to discuss that in the chapter. What else? What's happening at the beginning of the chapter? Jennifer, you want to say what? Yeah, sure. What was that?
I thought you were going somewhere else. What were you just asking?
I was just asking... how does the chapter start, and how can we make our way into this very good topic that Deirdre's brought up? So what's happening at the beginning of the chapter?
Well, they're going from the spirit world over the mists and down to the earth plane.
Yeah. And Fred saying, why'd you bring me here at night time? Like, I can't see anything. And Kushner goes on, doesn't he, to... He really just conveys a series of lessons, doesn't he, through a discussion. Yeah, so I'd love to just let's work our way through the lessons, what you guys saw as the truths that were pointed out in this discussion, and then we'll get on to some good discussion as we go, I think, on the issue of why Fred can't see very well in the earth plane. So what's one of the major lessons or the truths you feel is imparted early on in the chapter? Raj, if you pass back Deirdre,
Thank you. I was under the impression in the spirit world that when you had a thought, particularly to move to a different place, you would instantaneously be there. But clearly, the flight is not quite as instantaneous.
Because
they seem to be journeying. It becomes a transit. Yes. They're conscious of actually moving from one place to another.
And if you think about it, in the previous chapter, that was it's been happening all the way through, hasn't it? He's been journeying, and at some point in the last chapter, he realised, hang on, but I haven't really been walking. It hasn't really been that arduous. So he's learnt this new truth. It's controlled by my desire or my thought. But you're right, Raj. He's still taking the journey. He still gets to see them crossing the mist, doesn't he? So why do you reckon that is? Do you think you've had it wrong in thinking that you instantaneously travel in the spirit world?
I can't answer that.
Yeah.
Well, I think there's different ways of travel for different people. Maybe some are flying first class and others are going baggage.
Yeah.
Steerage.
Well,
It seemed that Symides and Mahini, for example, just appeared instantaneously.
Yes.
Whereas he's still having to journey slowly. Maybe it's to do with the vibrational frequency. that he's carrying that he hasn't shifted to
What's another word we could use for vibrational frequency?
Oh, just love. Just yeah, state of love.
Yep.
Is not high enough yet to make that instantaneous transition. Yeah.
And there could be another purpose for it as well. What do you reckon that might be? If you pass next door, next door.
It seems like everything's being unfolded perfectly. So it's according to their needs. And they're giving him time to observe things and talking to him along the way and giving him time to absorb and see.
Yeah, they are, because he's commented a few times already, hasn't he, just how overwhelming, how much information is being shown to him through his experience. Yeah. And what's the other thing that happens as this, because he's taking a journey, he gets to, if you pass behind Glenna, what might be a purpose? Yeah.
I was just going to say, there is no time limits there. So what may seem like a long journey to me, because that's what I need to learn, as Sue was saying, but to the person who's requested presence, it might seem instantaneous.
Yeah, I do believe that some of those spirits in very high conditions can just arrive. But as you're both saying, there's the provision for learning in the way that Fred is travelling at the moment, isn't it? He's getting to see, I don't go through the mists, I go across the mists. So that's bringing new lessons and learning to him all the time, isn't it? Yeah. Graham?
He may also be limited by his own expectations. You know, he's used to walking everywhere, so that's what he ends up doing to start with, and then he slowly realises that you can go other ways.
Yes, yes. And that's a great point to bring up. It's something that I'd like to highlight as a theme in this chapter, the way our expectations and beliefs limit our experience. It's a huge theme all the way through what he learns and his experience. So good point, Graham. All right, so that is very true, as Raj points out. We get to see that he's in a different way of transport. He's not walking, but he's going on a journey. What else did you see in the early part of the chapter? What were some points for reflection, Yvonne?
I just want to ask a question, Mary, about something, and that is this travel different? In other words, not instantaneous, because you're actually going across the mists to the earth plane, as opposed to, would it be instantaneous in the spirit world, or is it just dependent on condition of love?
Well, remember Fred's been journeying. Remember when he went to see Marie?
Yep.
He journeyed, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And he noticed there was a change in the light and there was the dew, the unusual dew and things. So I think my personal feeling is it depends on your condition and your desire, like everything in the spirit world. So some people in a very high condition of love
can go
instantaneously. Mm. Other people are perhaps limited in how quickly they can, often, as Graham said, limited by their belief system, but also by the capability of their soul because of their condition. But also sometimes it's done on purpose to take the journey so that you can learn. So Fred, in coming down to meet Marie in the Harvest of Jealousy, he got to see that they were altering their appearance, that they were going into a darker condition. And he learnt a lot from that, didn't he?
He also questioned whether Kushner was providing some of the energy necessary even for this journey.
Yes.
And so if he was on his own, maybe he can't even travel the way he was this time.
Yeah, so let's talk about why might you need to be loaned energy?
Because your condition of love is not high enough.
And what does that mean practically?
In practicalities, it means that you can't just go wherever you want to go. So you can only go to places that are going to be the same as your soul condition.
Yeah, but if we think about Fred, he's coming across the mist to the earth plane. So he's in a higher condition of love than the earth plane. So why do you think he might be needed to be loaned energy, Kel?
To assist him to keep learning.
Yeah, so why would it be taxing? Why wouldn't he have enough of his own energy?
He hasn't got to that level of love yet.
Yep. I want you guys to think about why you get tired in your own life.
Can I ask a question about this as well that might relate?
Yeah,
about
sure.
Him saying there was no effort in my flight. Like, even though his condition of love is, you know, where it is, lower than Kushner's,
yep,
that he still felt it was not an effort.
Yeah, so he's saying also in that sentence, he's saying, I'm not having to walk up hills and feeling it in my body. It's not a strain or a drag. Yep, yep, that's right. But he is saying, there is the question, is he loaning me energy? And now I'm just asking the question generally, why might we need to loan someone energy? Yep, if we go to Luli.
Because a fear is coming up in him, and that's why he's getting tired.
Yes.
Well, yeah, emotions, because it's so confronting, it's tiring.
Yes, because he's being emotionally bombarded all the time, there's all these emotions going on. And if you guys think about when you get emotionally bombarded and you don't have the chance to process it physically, you get much more tired, don't you? So to me, it's kind of logical that maybe some people are loaning Fred some energy along the way. Yvonne?
I'm just having a little chuckle. Is that why we go out and eat so much food at the breaks on the seminars?
Yep, sometimes I think. Something to sustain me through the next bit. Glenda?
It just seems like there's a little contradiction, because I've heard AJ said that when we enter the spirit world and we have a thought that we're in one part of the world, then we're there instantly, and then we think about something else and we're there instantly. So why is it in this case that they're travelling and having a journey?
Why did we just say, Glenda, you weren't listening?
To learn.
Yep.
Is it because we've got control over where we're going this time, whereas...
Yeah, okay. So when AJ's spoken about that, if you think about when you are denying or suppressing emotion, especially dark emotion, well, that's the only emotion we generally suppress, dark emotion, then we are driven by the desire to do that, basically, or to act it out rather than feel it. So if you think about in the case of Marie, she was drawn to her former lover because she was still in a rage, she still felt all this jealousy, she still didn't want to deal with it, and so she was drawn whammo to him. Now, if you think about it, that's very often what happens in your day-to-day life when you are avoiding something. Your whole purpose is to avoid that thing. And it directs your actions, it directs who you're speaking to, it directs what you eat, what you wear, all these things all happen as a result of you avoiding that one emotion. So when AJ's talking about that, he's talking about the soul, and the soul's condition actually has the biggest power when you're in the spirit form. You are led by that. So can you see how in Fred's story, that is also still the case? Can you see how it's not a contradiction at all?
Yeah, so it's got actually nothing to do with the fact of what's possible, like that we can get there instantly.
Yes.
But it's got to do that I'm choosing to learn along the way. So
yeah.
It becomes a journey rather than an uncontrollable...
If you imagine someone who passes into the hells, they are driven by the desire to avoid responsibility and to avoid feeling. And they are pulled in every direction by that desire. That one overreaching desire leads to a huge amount of experiences. In Fred's case, he has the desire to learn and understand and to share that knowledge. So that one desire is guiding every one of his experiences right now. So it's possible that he could suddenly be back on the earth plane, but that's not really his desire. He wants to understand how everything's happening. So the whole environment of the spirit world is always based around our desires. The people in the hells, they're also in an environment where everything is being dictated by their desire, and it's their desire to avoid.
So travel's actually been slowed down then for the purpose of learning and fulfilling a desire?
In a sense, but also as someone else raised, time is not as we understand it here either. So it's... I guess the way I think about Fred's journey is that he's not journeying, he's just learning based on desire, and everything he's seeing It's not necessarily he's considering it a journey. Like, for example, in this situation, he's suddenly journeying across the mists and that's teaching him something. So he doesn't say, and we walk for hours or we effortlessly move for hours through the rolling hills and, you know, looked at the daisies. Like, that's not really what's happening, is it? He's being in a desire straight away and that's governing what's happening. Yeah. Yeah. Is that clear?
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Nina?
It also strikes me that all the way through, Fred's had this desire to learn, attracts the people who are going to create the right circumstances for that to be possible, because he went there and, wow, this is amazing, I want to tell everybody on earth. So he attracts circumstances that show him how that needs to eventuate. And yep. What it highlights for me is, yet again, and it sounds kind of new agey, but we really need to walk those steps to that end point, so it has significance when we get there. Yeah.
Well, there'd be no point just like sticking us in front of like 5,000 people and going, tell them the secrets of the universe, and we go, oh, that's an end goal desire, but I've got no idea. I haven't even experienced any of it yet, so yeah.
So his humility opens him up to attracting the right people.
Absolutely.
To him as well.
Yeah. And as he says, that's another one of the lessons in the chapter, isn't it, later on, where Krishna says, he talks, well, what does he say about that very point? Who can tell me, if you like?
It's about the alphabet and be patient, so yeah. That although we have some of the letters of the alphabet, we're not yet writing sentences.
Yeah.
So to, once again, just to take those steps of learning along the way.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
To acknowledge those steps and to be patient with ourselves.
Yeah. He says that each successive stage through which we passed will have its mystery, but in turn will be solved and give place to greater problems until all of our powers having been unfolded, we shall see God. And I was going to ask you guys, have you thought about that in relation to your own journey? Did it make you think about that as you were reading it? Sometimes I see lots of you, when I asked some people a while ago to tell me the three most significant truths they'd learned since meeting us, and some of them were saying all these really like, I'm not quite there, but I'm pretty close to this truth. And I was thinking, wow, no, rewind 3 years ago. Where were you then? Like, what have you learned in those 3 years that have actually changed your whole life, really? Just even some people's conception of God as a loving being, or the human soul as it exists, and even things that are even more minor than that. It's a lovely exercise to consider who you were 3 years ago and go, how have I changed? Really from that person back there, not the one I'm trying to. It's great to focus on the one I want to become, but don't forget who you were and how much you've passed through. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, what other lessons do we see in this chapter? Or there's some very interesting points that Krishna raises about society's idea of death. What do you guys feel about that, Sarah?
That the physical world is more powerful, and it's what's substantial, it's what's real to everyone, whereas the spirit world is sort of this insubstantial kind of
floaty.
Yeah, ethereal kind of, can't really, no substance. And in here, in the earth state, we can do things, we can change things, we can, you know, do everything like that. And then once we die, that's not too bad if you didn't get to do it in the earth state.
Who has those kind of feelings inside of them? Death puts down at foot and says to the mighty influences of the mind, thus no further. That's it. It's over. Yeah. I come from a bit of a family background that you've got to make the most of this life because, you know, and it becomes a real pressure. Am I having fun? I should be having more fun. I should be doing more things. Yeah.
But also the fact that the spirit world is unreal and it's mystical and strange and there's nothing substantial in it or anything like that.
Yeah.
That's still an error that I have.
When you imagine the spirit world, how do you imagine it? Is it sort of a bit floaty, misty? So what's the truth that we learn in this chapter? What is the spirit world like when you're a spirit? if we go to Gary at the back.
Yeah, well, what struck me with Fred was, like, the spirit world was actually more real than Earth.
Yeah.
You know, and I was just thinking the other day, like, you know, this chair is pretty real, and I was banging on it, like, you know, and then... And then I thought, like, how can the spirit world, like, be more real than that? Like, he felt, like, more solid in the spirit world, yet he's floating across the mists, you know? So, yeah. And yeah. His reality was so sharp and clear that Earth was actually fuzzy, you know? So we're the ones that were floaty and not real.
Yeah.
So it shows how real his reality was in the spirit world, which is sort of scary because, like, it's actually a real, physical, living world, and I've got trouble getting my mind around that.
Yeah. Well, I think it's really interesting for all of us to consider that. When I'm in a physical body, this physical world is really tangible to me. As soon as I leave my physical body, that spirit world is just, if not more, tangible to me. Like, if you do... Like, it's worth... trying to get your head around, because it does alter it, for me it alters a lot of perceptions I have about spirits also. Yvonne?
I only had a chance to read this twice but I really feel there's a lot of clues here for how we can start to see the world as a spiritual place,
mm-hmm.
and clues for us as to how we can do this now in terms of seeing it differently. I'm not there yet. But in terms of, I think that's the direction that it's leading us.
It's a very good point you raise. So what do you think some of the clues are? What's it telling us?
I think, well, it's love for a start, because love overcomes
come on, I love how you guys all go, well, it's just love. And and I say, it's his condition of love that governs him. Yeah, but why? What does that mean? It reminds me of, you know, in the castle. It's Marbo, it's the vibe, it's, you know, it's the general... you have to have seen the castle to get that, but yeah. It's the constitution. Thank you, I rest my case. Yeah. So let's get specific. What do you mean?
Okay.
If someone could...
I thought that the talk that Jesus gave us on the weekend was very pertinent,
yes.
in a way, that... if we were really taking on all of those gifts that God was giving us and only walking in a way that was, one, connected to God and therefore presenting the word of God,
yeah.
then that would be a starting point. Like, I'd have to be in that place, I think, to be able to see it from the spiritual side.
Yes. So where does it mention that in the chapter, Ange? Because it does mention that.
I think it mentions it here simply because we've changed the standpoint of our observation and in doing so have become invisible to Earth. I think there was somewhere else as well, but...
He talks about... it's actually on page 146 of this book.
I don't know what that is.
Near the top.
Point of sensation of resistance, that was a key as well, I feel.
That is the key. But just on the... There's a lot of clues in this chapter. But if we're just on the point that Yvonne was pointing out about walking in a way that's in harmony with God's truth.
Okay.
Is that what you were saying? Yeah. If we're upholding those principles. He says on the second last page of the chapter, they arise entirely from misconception... the misconception I've referred to, and I'd like to talk about those misconceptions. Oh. Give us on the earth side a base of operation which would exist if the simple teachings of Jesus were followed and the rest would be very easily accomplished.
Can someone give us a page in the other book for that?
The paragraph starts with yes, but by no means insurmountable. So that's really... Kushner is saying to him... Well, what is Kushner saying to him? He's saying to him, if everyone just really followed these simple teachings, and he's even referring here just to some basic Bible teachings, then there'd be about love and loving your neighbour and things like that, then it'd be much easier for us to convey this truth on the planet. But there are other things that he points out, and some of that, Ange, you were talking about.
Well, I feel that is the standpoint, you know, that of our observation, and that is the point of sensation, the of point resistance.
Of resistance, yeah. So he, what's he saying by that?
Well, once we have changed, once we have seen the truth of who we are, who God is, everything changes. Our point of view changes. I don't know.
Yeah.
How.
So when we pass over through the mists, what changes for everyone?
Well, we believe we're dead. We know we're dead.
We know we're not dead.
We're not dead. Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry. I knew what you're trying to say. Yeah. We know we're not dead.
Yeah.
And so immediately, we also know that Earth exists because we've just been there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that point of difference does actually assist the spirit to be able to communicate a lot better, doesn't it?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yvonne, yeah.
I think it's also pertinent, and he refers to it in there somewhere, that what Jesus taught us in the first century by the crucifixion and then resurrecting, because one of his main goals then was to show people that, well, life doesn't stop, mm-hmm. life does continue,
mm-hmm.
and actually appeared many times in a spirit form.
Mm-hmm. And spoke to spirits.
And spoke as well.
And the whole Bible is based around the idea that it was revelation.
Yes.
So, or a lot of the books of the Bible are written in that way, through channeling or mediumship, through prophecy.
And so I don't think we're living that truth.
No, and I believe that's one of the things he was referring to when he says if everyone just looked at the simple teachings of Jesus, things would be a lot more wide open between these two spheres, the earth plane and the the spirit world. Yep.
Mm.
Yep. There's a lot more to it. So let's talk about what does he tell Fred? It's all there in the discussion that he has with Fred. After he talks about we have to learn the alphabet before we learn the language, what does he talk about in the next paragraph? Page 145 of the printed book. Karina, at the back there, if you pass back, Gary.
I just actually didn't want to skip over that bit about...
we're not skipping, we're just skipping all over the place today. Yeah.
Yeah, well, to me it was very pertinent about allowing that mystery as you're learning because he said if our friends on earth could recognise this, they would fulfil their mission better. I know that you're talking about the love conquers death one.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Well, he's talking about...
But you're allowed to talk about that point, Karina.
Oh, well, it was just very meaningful to me because when things are a mystery and I'm overwhelmed, then I can go in that downward spiral. And I love the way he earlier said, 1,000 things were rushing through my mind and he stays open to learning and I just didn't want to rush over that.
And one of the things you have to feel before you can ever become at one with God and actually progress very far is the idea that I'm not going to know everything. There's never going to be one point where I know everything and I'm in total control. If I really want to know God and grow towards God, I will give that up and just keep moving and love mystery. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's the God-reliant part of it where it's just that relaxing, like open-minded, open-hearted, like a child.
Yeah.
And it's just so, there's so much receptivity then to learn on a soul basis.
Yeah. Cool. All right, but we're talking about why there's this big division between spirits and mankind, we can call it that, and communication. So what's the lesson in the next paragraph?
Can I just say with this next paragraph, I had a question. In that love one.
Yes, okay. That's good.
Yeah. It says sympathy.
am I leading this book group or is it you, Karina?
Oh, my God.
It's all right. Keep going.
I'll put my hand up to that. Sympathy, whether pure or impure, base or noble, holy or unholy, has a natural attraction for that which is, and its power is not destroyed by the grave. Yeah, I just, sympathy, whether pure or impure, still seemed to be a good thing. And
well, let's talk about that. Was this a big question for me there.
Yeah.
What's your question?
Well, I'm looking at myself with trying to be clean with my addictions and having empathy, not sympathy, and trying to be clean in my interactions and learning how to be loving with others. And so for myself, I felt that when I thought I was being loving and I was actually in addictions, I wasn't being loving, so that doesn't seem to have a good result.
Can you see that you still haven't asked a question?
Okay.
What was your question?
If I give to another and it's impure, is that still a good result? Is that still...
Who wants to answer that question? Deirdre? I just pointed that out, Karina, because there's a lot of... Can you feel what was going on for you there in that interaction? Yeah.
That was kind of one of the first things that we talked about, and it was like if you have an impure motivation behind a good deed, it's not really love.
Yeah, yeah. So no matter if we're not really coming from a pure place, what can happen really? We're only going to be shown the impurity, aren't we? Yeah. But that's not actually what this is talking about. What is this talking about, Luli?
Okay, I've only just thought about this. So okay. I think it's talking about the law of attraction and how if someone grows in love, then that can kind of pull other people along a little to grow as well. Mm. Am I vaguely on the right track?
You're vaguely on the right track. It involves laws, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. What would be the other law it involves? It's the law of attraction and... Does anyone else know the law? Rita?
No, just no.
Okay.
Talk about communication.
Yep. Everyone's having a really hard time answering just the questions that I'm asking. What's going on? So it's after the paragraph that we spoke about earlier, which is about every successive stage through which we pass is a mystery. It's on 123 of your printed one, Geraldine. It's on 145 of the book. Is everyone just feeling like you're not following the discussion? Yeah. Can I just say, when I ask a direct question and then you add in all your other comments and your other questions about different things, then we end up, the conversation does get very disjointed. I know where I'm heading and I know it's not the only place we're going to head today. It's just the style of getting you guys to reflect on a certain point, and then we can certainly answer other questions. But a lot of you feel like a little bit pressured to make your point, or is it just that you don't understand where we're at?
No, I was answering.
Rita, would you?
I was answering your question.
Okay.
You answered a minute ago, 30 seconds ago.
Okay, let's just take a pause because I just need to connect to myself for a bit here. Okay. Would you like to say something, Rita? It's okay, but could you just raise your hand? Because that way... No. If you don't have the microphone, please don't speak. Just because that's out of respect for everything, the way we've been running the group. Okay. All right. This is the point I feel we all need to learn. We don't have to learn it, but if we want to have a look at what's happening in this chapter, we're talking about why is there a barrier between the earth and the spirit world. Kushner is trying to help Fred understand it. And we talked about the fact that many people ignore the teachings of the Bible and of Jesus, and this is one of the barriers. But Kushner is also highlighting other barriers that occur and other laws that govern the way spirits and people on earth interact. So, yep, Lena, let's hear from you.
Is it love? Just the basic feeling for each other, which would connect naturally and bring togetherness.
So he's saying in this paragraph, isn't he? He's saying, yes, pure love does have an influence on bringing people together, be they be on earth or in the spirit world, they do come together. But what is that based on? That's a loving desire, yes, but there's a lot more to it in terms of laws that you guys have probably heard about, but maybe not for some time. Yeah, if we go to Luli and Sarah over here. Sorry, looking at the wrong one.
Law of rapport.
The law of rapport. And what does that law mean? Can you answer that? Is that what you're going to say?
I was going to say law of rapport. It's who you're sympathetic to, who you're drawn to, and that could be loving or it could be unloving. So, like, a drunkard might attract spirits who are drunk too, and there's a law of rapport between them and an openness to that connection. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there. But also a child who longs for their mother might be more loving. Yeah.
So it might be a more loving rapport.
More loving rapport, more loving connection.
Yeah, and what do you see when you read the Paget messages? They talk about this a bit with James Paget himself. Can you remember reference to that, anyone who's read the messages? Yeah, Alwyn at the back.
When he was in a good condition, he could actually connect to them, but there were times when something happened and he couldn't, and they just couldn't get through to him.
Yeah, and what would they tell him to do, can you remember?
Pray and... Yeah. You know, really get connected with himself, his soul and stuff.
So they're saying when you open up and long for God, then we can have more rapport with you. So what then is the law of rapport working on? Sometimes, as Sarah said, it's working sort of what we would deem in a negative direction and sometimes in a more positive direction. What do you think it's acting upon? If we go back to Rochelle.
Law of desire.
No, it is specific. It is specifically the law of rapport, but what's it acting upon in the soul of each person involved in the engagement?
The emotions.
Yeah, the emotions. What? I agree. There's more to it than that, though. If you pass forward to Jennifer,
The condition of the soul between the two different people, and even the beliefs that they have.
Yes. This is quite an important point, the beliefs.
And I know earlier in the book they talk about how on Earth there's so much misinformation, false beliefs about the spirit world,
yes,
that it creates such a barrier between communication between the two places.
Absolutely. And if you look at that in even in this chapter... He's talking about that as I think the paragraph Ange was referring to also, the sensation of resistance is different between the two states. What does that sentence really mean? The sensation of resistance, the point of sensation of resistance is different. Jen?
They don't want to know the truth, so it creates a resistance. It's like...
Yeah, it's actually, imagine I'm in the physical body and the physical world. This is my point here. And my resistance is, my resistance emotionally, intellectually, is to the spirit world, isn't it? So it becomes vague and hazy to me. When I'm in the spirit form, where's my point? And where's the resistance? Well, that's sort of weird now. I don't know what's going on here, but there's a resistance. And this is why I wanted to talk to you guys about beliefs. If my beliefs are false in some way, can you see how that causes a bigger division between us? Yeah? Cool. All right. Suzanne?
Uh,
isn't it contributed to by the very nature of how it is? Like, even if you're a medium and you can see the spirit world, you see it as hazy. And so...
Is that true, though?
Well, the only mediums... I don't know that many mediums, yeah. But it seems to be that everywhere that you read in books, nobody ever says, oh, boy, a really solid person came and sat in my lounge room.
Except if you read Robert James Lee's forward.
It did happen. But was that because Kushner and Siamedes and eventually Fred had the ability to manifest more solidly in the physical realm?
This is a very good question. Does anyone have any idea on the answer to that question? Rita?
I think I have read somewhere that they did manifest more solidly in some other books about Robert James Lee. Maybe it was also in German I read it, I don't know, but they did manifest at one time really solid.
Yeah, that's what we're saying.
Could maintain the body for 10 minutes or then suddenly Fred disappeared because he lost the energy. And
That's what we're saying. They were very solid when they appeared to Robert James Lee's. But the question is that because of what they did or is that because of Robert? If you pass back okay. to... yep. Sherry.
Is it that Robert had no resistance to seeing them in that way so they could actually appear that way?
Yeah, it comes back to this issue of beliefs again. And this is why I'm bringing this up, because it's littered all the way through the chapter, actually, this idea that when my beliefs are open, then I see. When my belief is closed down, it's black. Lorleen? If you think about it, how many spirits do you think are in the room with us today? Like a gazillion. Yeah. And why can't we see them?
Yeah, because I don't want to.
Yeah, I'm afraid. My belief is they'll be able to hurt me if I see them. They'll be yucky. Or can you see it's really a lot about beliefs? Lorleen?
I was just trying to relate it again to why I can't see things about my life and why I selectively choose things, because mm-hmm. I was just looking at this thing about sensations of resistance is different. Mm-hmm. And if I don't want to know about, because it's too painful, I don't want to know about my father, I won't... I won't feel it, I won't know it. So if this is just happening on my immediate understanding, then if I'm referring this again to the difference between a spirit world and the earth plane, it's of the same nature to me. It's just of a magnitude different, you know?
Yeah, so and this is one of the major lessons that I felt from this chapter was this. Our beliefs can make us blind. Because it's true. If you consider it in your own life, if you have a resistance to feeling things about your father, if you believe I can't handle that, it couldn't possibly be true, whatever the belief is, you'll be blind to it.
Yeah, and may I continue?
Yeah.
It was just, I asked myself why, even though I do get images of occasionally spirits, why I don't want to see them. And I had a whole lot of reasons why I don't want to see them, and they varied from if I did, it'd have to make me believe certain things, and I wouldn't be able to stay with my addictions because then I'd have to see what I was actually doing. And I went through a whole... like a series of points of I don't really, even though I say I want to see them, I don't really want to, because it also makes me look at death mm-hmm. and all of these things. Mm-hmm. So if I'm really honest with myself, I can see I don't really want to see, you know. So if I transfer it into a different, what we're just talking about, that same thing.
Yeah, yeah. Because Krishna's telling him a lot of truths about the way spirit interaction happens, but or doesn't happen, fails to happen, or why it's hard to see the earth plane at, for when they're in a spirit form, for Fred especially. But yes, there is a lot of metaphor for how this relates to our life. I love that you thought even about what are my beliefs about spirits that prevent me seeing. Because really the message is in here that you can see, and you can see very clearly. Did someone have their hand up? No. Suzanne? Dylan.
Oh, I don't know if it's relevant, but what's happening for me is that, like, for me, a belief's intellectual, and yet it feels that my resistance is really emotional. It almost comes before I can even think about anything.
Yeah, and I put to you that your beliefs are all emotional. We create a big tap dance intellectually, but sometimes, like Lorraine pointed out, we go, I believe I really want to see spirits, but emotionally we're like, I don't want to see them. Yeah. That to me is the real belief.
Yeah.
And the intellectual is just like stuff that I tell myself because I think that that's what I should be like or what I would like to be like or, you know. So, yeah. Gary?
Yeah, just with spirits being, you know, from the Catholic background, like, you know, it was like in the book, you know, once you're dead, okay, Christ rose from the dead and that's all, folks. That's all you need to know,
yep.
You know, and then everything else was demons and devils and you know, something going to come and get you. And, I mean, in the groups we often talk about spirit attack and all this type of stuff.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Hey, do we want to see spirits or not really? You know, so I just didn't realise, like, how powerful I just don't want to or I don't believe, and that just creates irreality, like. And somebody else could be sitting right next to you and they can see them and you can't, like, in saying, well, where are they, you
yeah,
know?
Yeah.
So it just seems like so stark, you know?
Yeah, 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 definitely. Raj?
Maybe if we stood on the other side of the mists, we might say your beliefs can make you invisible.
Yes, and this is the other point that I wanted to raise, because there is this issue. There is the general feeling that when Fred goes across the mists, it's dark. Now, why is that? Deb?
It does say in the book that later on, I could just get the quote, it's the level of charity. I'm on the right chapter, aren't I?
At the end of this chapter?
Yeah, that I hope I didn't skip ahead and read in another chapter, but no, I read it. In the last... The last paragraph, the second last paragraph.
Yeah.
The light. He's talking about the, you know, the darkness shall cover the earth and gross darkness the people. The light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. This is a condemnation that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil.
So what does that mean?
So. Well, I thought it said, I wrote it in my book actually, that it shows the question of the level of the spiritual thermometer. Is it the spiritual thermometer? Yeah, that's the cold, but it's also about the light, wasn't it?
Yep. What does it actually mean?
the amount of charity, he says it, the charity.
Yep.
It's a level of how much charity is around, how much light is around.
Okay. So what I'm asking you guys to do is really practically analyse what you're reading. So when you read it's about the level of charity, okay, I know it's black, he's saying it's about charity. So what does it mean then? What's the relationship with charity and blackness?
Well, charity is love and... And because now we know that God has created the whole of the universe with love, it's all based on love, then it just shows that the darkness just shows the lack of love.
So the truth we can gain is when we grow in love, our spirit body becomes brighter.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Can anyone else think about some of that stuff? If we pass back to Jennifer.
Yeah, so when we grow in love, like you said, we grow in lightness. And so they're in the spirit world and they're in a good place in the spirit world. So when they're coming across the mists back to the earth, it's a much darker place.
Yes.
Because the general condition of the earth is like in the hells.
Yes.
And so what they will have to do in order to interact is to actually bring their energy down to the level of the earth where they can actually even see it.
Yes.
Because they couldn't even see it. It was so different from their own degree of soul condition.
Yes, exactly. And there's something more. If you pass back to Denise.
I also felt like it was his belief made him blind. So he came with the expectation he would see the world as he could before, and he couldn't. So he questioned what he was seeing. Even though he was seeing the truth, he thought it must be dark. It's not light yet.
Yes.
So it was easy, like we can be shown the truth, but because we have an expectation, we don't see it as that. And then we start to make suggestions of what it could
be. Based on our beliefs.
Yep.
Yes. Definitely. But what about Raj made a very beautiful point. He said, if I was a spirit, I could say to the other side that their beliefs make them blind. So that's in two ways, really. There we're looking at the idea that everyone on Earth, as we talked about earlier, they have this belief that the spirit world's all shady and misty and actually I'm a bit afraid of it and I don't really want to know. But also, if you also take that, if we know that the law of rapport is based on emotion and beliefs, and just as Jennifer said, the whole of the Earth plane is kind of in this obscure kind of darkness because of the collective emotions and beliefs, it literally is like a blindness. It's a blindness sort of metaphysically as well as emotionally. Denise?
So also with the law of rapport, we have to be in that situation where we're open to know. We want to be known, or we want to learn. So we want to be open, or we need to be open to learn about the spirit world, but also to have them know us. I might have mucked it up a bit, but do you know? Do you understand what
Absolutely.
I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. We have to be open-hearted, open-minded.
Yeah. So we won't see them and be able to communicate with them in the spirit world till we're open and wanting to do that and also allowing them to know us as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Right?
I think that's where the word sympathy comes in. It's an energy. It's like a union. Rather than the way we think of sympathy or giving sympathy to somebody, this is about a sympathetic relationship between two beings.
Thank you, Raj. Exactly. Do you have an electronics background or anything, a scientific background of a description of sympathy that you could help everyone with? That's putting
No.
you completely on the spot. Good. Anyone else? How do you understand sympathy in terms
Ego.
Of... if you go back to Geraldine behind Denise there, yeah?
Just the little bit that I know about, like sound, and so, for instance, with a tuning fork, I suppose, which I've never used, but just as an example, if you get a tuning fork in the key of E,
yep.
and then that will resonate on the guitar string as an E or something, but it's like. When champagne glasses crack as well, because it sets up a sympathetic
resonance
between the singer's voice, very high voice, and it makes the glass vibrate at the same rate, and the glass can't stand that.
Yep. Yeah. So that's a resonating at the same with the same sort of thing. But is sympathetic attraction in science always in that way? Lily?
Oh, well, you have positive and negative charges that are drawn together and then the negative charges are repelled from each other.
Yes, Yes, exactly. So what could you deduct about the law of rapport and spirit relationships based on that knowledge, knowing that what Kushner is saying, that it's sympathetic? Sorry, guys, I feel like I'm really asking you to take leaps, but I'm so excited about this material. I can just talk about it for an hour, but I think it'll be less fun for you.
Right.
So you just told us that sympathy can be through positive and negative charges coming together.
So there's an openness to receive in one and an openness to give in another.
Yes. So in terms of spirit interaction, what might you see between a person on earth and spirits in the spirit world? An openness to one sort of an emotion and a willingness to give it in the other. Can you see how that very often occurs? And so I feel that Kushner is also giving a lesson about this when he says that it might be base or noble, pure or impure. He's also saying that these attractions happen sympathetically all the time. Who had their hand up just there? Was that Graham? No? Kate? No? No one anyway. Lena and then Raj.
About the vision, I had almost like a vision of what they may have seen and shared, the darkness and unawareness. But I think for me, or my understanding, the putting two together, you know, the understanding that, yes, we have all this dark emotions or the beliefs or wrong, you know, misleading ideas in our heads, but what it actually does to us. Because we see, you know, the sun is shining, it's fair enough and it's all good. But then when he comes back and actually puts the two together, that it is dark.
Yep.
Because we are.
Yes.
And yep. That's the little light that we have.
Yeah.
So that was a really powerful, I guess, image, like the actual awareness of...
of where the earth plane is actually at in terms of... If you think about that in terms of rapport, who do we have the most rapport with? The people in dark, dark conditions. Hey, yeah, yeah. If you pass across to Raj.
Thank you. Just going back to the magnetic concept there and the... I've lost it. it just seems that... Oh, I know what it was. It's the basics of communication. I mean, if we look at... we've taken communication for granted and we see it in a kind of a bleak way here. But all we're really talking about is finding someone who wants to give information or give themselves and somebody who wants to receive something from another that is what the other one is giving. It's the same thing as us having a conversation.
It is.
And we've mixed it up. We've let go of...
Well, is it that we've mixed it up or is it that emotions and beliefs govern our true desires? And so you and I want to have a chat about Through the Mists, and our emotions and beliefs are relatively in harmony on that subject. Not all of us are in good harmony today, but when we come to talking with spirits, like, is it just that our beliefs and our emotions are not always in good rapport?
Yeah, maybe we don't want to hear what they're saying. And so, therefore, they can't communicate with us.
Very often, I don't want to hear what they're saying because sometimes they're not very nice to me, you know. Yeah. But does that always serve us? Does that serve us?
No.
We seem to still carry on with this idea that ignorance is bliss, don't we?
I think the opportunity is too huge to ignore.
If you just pass forward to Graham, Raj, and over here to Yvonne.
If you want to talk about some of the electronic side of things.
Yes.
When we do MP3 data compression, for example, or MP4s for the videos, you have to have a decoder at the other end, which is similar to the encoder at one end. So both the transmitter and the receiver have to be structured in the same way. And if you can do that, your transmission can involve a lot less data.
Uh-huh.
And it's like when we speak to each other, I can only tell you about things that we have common experience of.
Mm-hmm.
If I try and tell you about things that we don't have common experience of, you don't have the decoder at your end to be able to decode what I'm saying to you.
No, I have to ask you not only for the experience but for the decoding information, don't I?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah, good analogy, Graham. So you could say that that is a lot like rapport and how spirit communication has to work.
Exactly.
Yeah. Cool. All right. I want to talk to you guys a lot about the lessons, these three things that I've got written on the board in relation to how you guys feel this relates to your life. But perhaps you'd like to talk more about the chapter before we do that. So let's talk about the chapter, and then if you care to join me, we'll head off on that that bit of reflection. Yvonne, what did you?
It's not nearly necessary, but I've just been sitting here for the last 5 or 10 minutes feeling about the emotions, mainly fear, that we have, that I have towards the spirit world, and the beliefs that I have as to what's possible, so what's making me blind. I'm just thinking, there's just such a huge... If that's the same for everybody on the planet, given that most of us are in the first sphere, that's just a huge projection on the spirit world. Like, we're sending so much stuff over there, we worry about what they're going to do to us. We should start thinking about what we're doing to them. In terms of where our emotions and beliefs are and what that's doing.
Yeah, well, our fear collectively is... Well, I feel it's demonstrated really clearly in the chapter what it's creating.
Mm.
This very black environment that's quite sort of unpleasant for a spirit to come to. Yeah, good point. Okay, let's talk about the chapter. Kel?
I was just thinking about the belief that God is unchangeable and this chapter of the religion saying God has said his last word and how that belief for the last couple of thousand years, which is a belief I have bought, that and what it's caused on the planet, the darkness just in that one belief of God being unchangeable. So it sort of made me reflect on a simple belief I have in my life and how then that can affect.
Well, do you feel that it's saying that God is changeable or that the belief that... What do you feel it's saying about the changeable nature of God?
I feel it's an error belief that God is... God is not changeable in his laws. But that's not the last word.
Yes. So what is the point it's trying to make about Christianity?
The power and control. The belief of... I just think of the people who wrote the Bible and the belief and the power and control, how much they must have wanted to set that belief pretty much in stone.
Because what he's saying there, isn't it, about the changeless God, is that he's saying these people who wrote the Bible said God is changeless, but they also included all this stuff about spirit mediumship. But now they say, that's changed, there's no more. So he's pointing out how illogical that belief is, isn't he? Yeah.
I don't know if you can explain the following bit as well. I sort of was a bit confused about his last word in that respect. Therefore, argue that any attempt to break the silence of the tomb is an artifice of the devil to destroy their souls. And sort of... I didn't quite get all of that, but I don't know if you have a good explanation for all of that.
Which page is that on? Is that just at that point as well?
Yeah, the same paragraph. I haven't got the same book.
Yeah, that's okay. Does anyone have... I've got a paragraph that talks about the reappearance of Christ after death as the cornerstone of their faith.
It's pretty much...
1, 2, 3? 1, 4, 3. Okay, page before. Oh, yep, gotcha. So what's your question, Kel?
Just about explaining what that all really means.
So it's saying there, they fondly... So as we said, that they believe that spirit communication happened, but now they fondly imagine that God has said his last word in that respect. That's it. The Bible is the word of God no more. And
Therefore, they argue that any attempt to break the silence of the tomb, so any attempt to speak with someone who's passed over, is an artifice of the devil to destroy their souls, is the work of the devil that's going to lead to their downfall. God. So they're saying Christians have the belief that all this angelic revelation came, we made the Bible, that's it, all over. Now, anyone who speaks to us from the tomb, from beyond the grave, that's all the work of the devil. And we should never go near it. Yeah. If you pass back to Peter right at the back.
I felt that in the church, in the communication, that the church very much is essentially saying no communication with spirits. Really, we can talk with God, and you just need to listen to what we say.
Yes.
So that to avoid a can of worms.
To avoid a can of worms, absolutely. And you know what strikes me sometimes, Peter, is that I see people in a Christian faith who believe they're speaking to God when they're actually speaking to spirits, but they believe it's wrong to speak to spirits. And it all gets very confusing because there's this desire to hold on to a certain strict set of rules, and because there's no further investigation down this road, it ends up being very confusing, and people believe God's telling them things when actually it might be a guide or it might be someone in a lower sphere. And yeah, has anyone else had that feeling? Yeah, quite a few of you. Yeah. If we pass back to Jennifer and forward to Glenda. Yeah.
Just to add to that, I used to be close with a number of Christian friends back where I used to live, and they are full of pride about how they have gotten revelation from God and that they follow God's word for them in everything they do. And now I understand what's really going on, so I feel really grateful for the truth, but it feels to me that the stumbling block is their rigidness and pride of how good that makes them feel that they get to talk to God and be directed.
Yeah, well, there's quite a few things, and it's not the same for every Christian either, is it? But again, can you see that this law is governing the interaction? They have a certain set of beliefs about Christianity, about the nature of God, that attracts a certain set of spirits who are willing to foster that belief in them. They either have the same belief or they have a sympathetic belief based on the, like, they have a desire for power or something. So we think, and these people want to be led. So, great rapport, off we go. Yeah, yeah. Glenda here. And then if you pass back while that's happening to Geraldine.
Just my experience as a child, I asked my mother one day, if mediums weren't talking to spirits, then how come what they said seemed to be correct? And her answer to me was just, oh, the devil knows you really well too, love.
Scary, huh? Yeah. But what do you feel about that in terms of... if we know there's, we all agree there's no devil, but there are spirits in a lower condition who don't have our best interests at heart. Do they know us pretty well? Yeah. Yeah. So they, it could be, we don't know who we're talking to unless what, we know how to figure out who we're talking to, don't we? How do you do it? Nina.
It's a sense of feeling them. What they're trying to do, whether it's loving, whether the feeling coming from them is loving.
Or, yeah. Yeah, well, there's lots of things we learn on the weekend, isn't there?
Yeah. Oh, I wasn't here on
oh,
the
you
weekend,
weren't there. So. Yeah, yeah. But it does involve you knowing yourself and feeling yourself, but then also analysing what they're telling you to do based on what you know of love. Yeah, yeah.
Can I say something about the chapter?
Yeah, can we go to Geraldine first and then we'll come back to you.
I felt that thing about God being unchangeable.
Yep.
For me, I felt that it was also about that they're saying that there's no possibility of any relationship with God, and that that it's kind of like saying God is set in stone, and that he's
Like, if we can have a live relationship with God, it would mean God is not unchangeable. He's not sort of set in stone. He's alive. He's changeable just in that he can respond to us. It's a live relationship.
Hmm. Did anyone else feel that from that part? I didn't feel that as much. I think it's interesting thing to reflect on for yourself, but I don't feel they were making that point about Christianity, because I feel a lot of Christians do believe you can have a personal relationship with God, but they just believe his nature will never change. And I share their belief on that. I feel that he will be changeless in his laws and also his nature. I believe, though, that he can respond to us in a unique way and that he can create things, but just that he is changeless in terms of his nature, yeah.
I guess I was thinking of it also in terms of the fact that the church traditionally has said you can't relate to God, you can only relate through us because we're the only ones that can relate to God.
Yeah, and that, well, only through following our set of laws are you going to be able to relate to God.
I had a kind of quite a revelatory realisation when I was reading that, because I was thinking that it related to people that didn't think that they could have a personal relationship with God. But then I had a realisation. I don't think you're listening to those yet, are you? We're just talking about the chapter.
No, that's all right. We're talking about the chapter and what you felt about the chapter. It's fine.
Yeah. I realised that my own projections to God, which are the same as my experiences with my parents, you know, that I'm projecting my relationship with my parents on God, and in that way it makes God for me a changeless, unrelatable to figure.
I see.
As in my parents judged me, my parents weren't interested in my desires or anything. And so, you know, I'm down there, they're up there, and I'm bad, and God will always see me as bad. But
So it is true that our perception of God is going to change. Our feelings and our relationship with God is in a process of change for most of us right now, isn't it? And in that way, it can kind of feel like God is changing, but I believe he's the constant one in the relationship. Yeah. Thank God for that, you reckon? Yeah. Cool.
Can I just say, it's kind of like he's not immovable. When I say he's changeable, it's like we can move him, he can be moved to respond to us.
But I think, Geraldine, this is really important, because I actually feel there's something in you about wanting God to move to your... He's not going to. He's not. He's going to be constant in the way he relates to you. And so I feel a lot of us want him to... We think, oh, yeah, we can get this God guy to, you know, come around. But we're not seeing that actually the only way we connect with God is when we make that change. So I do feel God is kind of immovable. He's immovable on his stance, on his ethics, on his way he will relate to us.
Yeah, it was just through a personal experience of having felt previously in some sense that I can't, you know, like God is, I was seeing God more as my parents. It was to do with my projection that I was putting on God.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I see that. Yeah. Mm. Yep. Yep. Okay. All right. Kate, you had your hand up. Oh, yep. Nina first and then we'll go to Kate.
I found it interesting to reflect on the correlation between warmth and charity, and how that when I truly act from a place of charity, it brings warmth.
Yes.
So it sort of was like when we are truly of service, how we bring warmth and light as mm-hmm. opposed to the heart of stone.
Yeah. Okay, Kate.
I guess it was just a small point relating more to what Geraldine was sharing, just about when we're talking about the Christian beliefs about God, that while there was the correct kind of belief about God being unchangeable, that sort of there was absent, like that he's infinite in nature, so that while it's not changing, it's an infinite revelation sort of thing?
Yeah, they're saying his revelation is limited to this book. That's all of God's truth that there is. And, yeah, that's true. That's not true. Yeah. Deb?
This might be a little making a bit off, but I just, when that discussion came up about the priests, the church elders not wanting, kind of closing off that spirit of communication, the first thing that occurred to me that had never occurred to me before, so maybe our friends up here, that because we had descended into such a dark place that, and I don't want to justify the church in any way, but because we'd descended into such a dark place, they no longer trusted, and we can all be, you know, mediumistic and spirit influenced. They probably saw people more spirit influenced in the darker places, and they went, "Oh, no, because we're not there anymore." Whereas back in the Old Testament and the old prophets and stuff, they were in a pretty pure condition to have, you know, they didn't have all the kind of distractions and the darkness that we went into in the Middle Ages, probably. So, but then I kind of went, "Oh," and then they played into this whole thing of the church elders that you're bad. And our parents are telling us you're bad, like Jordan was talking about. So it's like, oh my God, it's just been a real big cycle that's gone on and on and on, that we're all bad. Everyone's telling us, and that sort of stopped us. It was kind of true in one sense, maybe, but it stopped us from reaching up and changing our condition.
Yeah, well, there's a lot you said then, but the first thing I would say is, I believe that it was a method of control to shut down spirit communication. And it could have been in some kind of misguided paternal sense to protect people from the influence of dark spirits. But what does Krishna tell us about that? What does he tell us in this chapter? What is the main impediment to growth?
Listening to our guides, to a higher...
Yeah, the fact that truth can't get there because everyone's so shut down to it. There's this big block up. And he said if people would just, you know, look at even what happened in the Bible, it would open up and we could convey a lot of truth that would actually help a lot of people. Yeah, so I feel that perhaps you're right, Deb. Perhaps some people had some sort of kind of misguided well intentions, but I believe the answer to successful spirit communication, happy lives, is more information, not less. And they set up a situation where there's less information, not more, and a perpetuation of that, and so it ends up everyone just feeling in, like, you know, wandering around in the dark, metaphysically, spiritually, the whole thing. Yeah, yeah. Okay, does anyone else have any more questions about the chapter? Or comments about the chapter? No, that's it. Does anyone else really want to even talk about the Law of the Rapport and how it might relate to our life? Yes? Yep, okay. I thought we were a bit touch and go on that for a while. So let's go back to what we were talking about with the Law of Rapport. We were talking about, Krishna told us, didn't he, that sympathy guides this interaction. And we talked about it a little bit in terms of there can be like a positive and negative kind of effect where someone is willing to accept the beliefs or accept the emotions of someone else. They may not be in harmony, they may not be these same emotions, but they may be emotions that are willing to please each other. So what would be an example of that?
Just a simple one would be where one person wanted to be in control and the other person was willing to be compliant.
The other person desired to abdicate responsibility for their life. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that could cause a rapport. Any other ideas, Lorraine?
I think it's been mentioned often about the sexual rapport, that you feel you're really attracted to someone and... It's that sympathetic, you know, error in the you know?
Yeah, okay, so let's talk about that a lot more. So
we're talking in the chapter about the rapports that govern the relationship between spirits and people on earth. But what about in your day-to-day relationships? Do you think this still happens? Yeah? So what might be an example of when you feel really attracted to someone based on the law of rapport or rapport? If we go to Sheridan.
A simple one in my life is someone wanting to listen to me and I want to talk. So that happens a lot with Steve and I, and but it's an error.
Yeah. So what could you say is the belief that governs that rapport? Because I'm putting to you guys that it's mainly beliefs that govern rapport between the spirit world and here and between us in our relationships. So what's the common belief you and Steve have just around that issue?
I'm not sure, but just that that's okay.
Yeah. A woman should be able to talk, a man should listen. Yes. You both agree. You've both got that going on. Yeah, and so that creates a rapport, doesn't it? Now, you can see that, okay, maybe there's something a bit off about those beliefs, but it, nonetheless, it creates rapport. And can you see also how when you met, you were like, this is love. We are totally in love.
One of my friends actually said she didn't hear Steve talk for 2 years.
Wow.
Because I was like, la, 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 I would talk for both of us.
Yeah. So at that stage you didn't see that there was any issue at all though, did you?
I thought it was fabulous.
Yeah. You thought it was love. This guy, we are in love. So can you see how your beliefs made you blind to the truth?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, can anyone else see where this happens in their life, Alex? It's all right. It's okay, you can ask the question, yeah.
I'm not sure if it's related, but I've had this burning question for a while, actually.
Okay, is it about rapport, though?
Yeah.
Okay.
Does there have to be a hook into spirits, or can it just be a case of there's this rapport?
So do you want to give an example?
Well, I was looking at all my hooks into my mates, not necessarily spirits, but why I so want to hold on to my mates that I've had for 30 years, and so there's this huge connection there. And I realised that it was we were all drawn together as children. We didn't really belong to any group. We're kind of like ragtag sort of bunch of kids that all just
didn't fit in anywhere. So you kind of came together,
yeah. And so I feel the major overriding thing is this feeling of belonging. Mm-hmm. And so
based on what we're just talking about,
yeah,
and I'm putting to you, all of you, that rapport is largely based around beliefs, which are emotional, as we talked to Suze about. What do you think you're going, yeah, well, we just sort of all want to belong. But I'm putting to you there's some beliefs you have in common. Can you think of what they might be?
Well, there would be lots, I imagine. So that would be the hooks into spirits.
So now you're talking about spirits. You're using this situation with your mates as an analogy.
Yeah.
So then let's talk about what is a hook then. What do you think a hook is?
Well, a hook is what I'm trying to get from them.
Yes.
Which could be understanding, support, mateship, a sense of belonging. Okay, the belonging's there as well.
And you have a belief, don't you, that men can give this to you and you can give certain things to men in order to get it. Like you're having problems letting go. That's because there's something you still want to keep getting from them and you're still willing to give things to them in order to keep in that exchange.
Yeah.
That's creating your hook. And I'm saying it's really based around a lot of emotional beliefs that you have. And some of them are, what kind of a man am I if I don't have mates? You know, if they're all gone, so I've got, that's another belief that keeps you tied to mates.
Yeah.
And especially, you know, men who are of a certain age group and a certain background that I can relate to, then you add a lot more hooks, don't you?
It's not just any mates you want. You want these mates for a certain reason.
Yeah, but I kind of feel like it's changing as well. Like I don't... I kind of don't understand why some of the spirits are still hanging around me, because I'm not feeding their addictions so much anymore. Because now I want mates. I still want mates.
Yep.
But I'm not prepared to... I'm in integrity more, so I'm not prepared to compromise my soul in order to have that.
Yep.
Now I want...
And how do you find... What do you find with the spirits around you since you've done that?
Oh, I get attacked a lot.
Yeah.
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 But why don't they just go?
I'll tell you why.
Because I'm not giving them what they want.
You're not giving them what you want, but what do we know happens with... Who remembers that talk that we talked about addictions and spirit influence? What were the three things we talked about? If you just pass back to Jen to give us the answer.
One of the things that spirits want from us is a sense of delight when they attack us and we respond to that. So that in itself could be very satisfying to them, to really cause you trouble.
Yeah. And what are the things that we talked about in that talk, though? If we go back to Elizabeth behind you.
Is it bribery, threat, and blackmail?
And blackmail. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So in the first situation, you're in this really, we're getting on together, we're helping each other out with our addictions, and it's almost like a bribery. I'll give you this, you give me that. And then you say, hang on, I've grown in integrity now. Does that mean every desire in you to get that thing or give that thing is gone? It doesn't. It just means you've grown in integrity. I'm not willing to compromise on issues of love and truth right now. So, but the hole is still in you. So what's the best way to get you to come back to them? Threaten you. Blackmail you. If you don't do this, I'm doing this in your life. If you don't do this, I'm going to do it. Because they can see it's still there within you. And as Jennifer says, a lot of them then take extra pleasure in the fact that, wow, and now he's really frightened and that feels kind of interesting and exciting. And so that's why. Yep.
Sorry, I don't mean to be crude, but it's like sometimes I can feel them hooking in to get me to try and attack my partner.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually turn around and I say, piss off, and they go. And it's like, oh, okay, cool.
But they come back, don't they?
Yeah, they do keep coming back. So I've got to completely heal this hole.
Your willingness to get angry, what's that telling you?
Well, yeah. I still have so much fight in me that I don't want to, you know, sometimes going to fear and sometimes going to grief, but generally is that this is still like, just get away, and I just, sometimes I still want to just fight.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's indicating that there's fear and grief still in you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. I feel like, it's hard yakka today, hey? I feel like everyone's really having a hard time hearing me and everyone's having a really hard time like just like staying in the flow and yeah. What do you think is happening, Mon?
At least for myself, I'm under a lot of attack, so I don't hear and I don't fully open. They've been really intense, They've been really intense the few hours before coming. Yeah. So, like the women, all they have to do is project anger at me and I want to leave or I shut down. So that's what I feel.
Yeah. What does anyone else, what do you feel? Is it just sort of not interesting or? It's okay if you just tell me, Lorleen.
When I read this chapter, I kept falling asleep. I had to actually fall asleep and then get up and do it again and fall asleep. And I realised that's why I did this page of why don't I want to see spirits?
Yeah.
What beliefs in me do I have that frighten me to see them, really?
Yeah.
And I feel that the more we understand about them, the more we can connect with them. They don't want that. And
Yeah, well, Kushner's kind of giving us the keys, isn't he? He's saying, well, look, this is about this and this, and then it could all be wide open or much more open. So it sounds like for some of us it's triggering a lot of fear, just that thought. And then on the other side, there's all these spirits who are saying, we don't really want you to actually open up to the higher level spirits. We're pretty cozy in our relationship with you. Yeah. Anyone else? Any other feelings? Yep. If we go to Deb, then Alex, and then back to Chrissy. Yeah.
For myself, I just had the best week ever last week that I emailed you about, and then now I've been blocked since Saturday, and I'm kind of like almost kicking myself, like, God, what's happened? What's happened? So it's me blocked to myself to block to God.
Right, yeah. And remember we gave you lots of tools, or a specific tool on the weekend to go, once you get blocked, what do?
Pray to God. That's all I ever do.
No, remember we drew it. We drew it a fair few times. Deb is going great. Deb's actually like, wow, I'm really feeling well. And then she's like totally shut down. What do you do?
Pray.
What to do?
Pray. Yep.
Feel what I'm feeling.
Feel where what you're feeling. Also, you can go back to this point. What happened right then?
Yeah, I was doing that in the car all the way here, and I had some laws of attraction that happened that I didn't feel at the time. It was inconvenient and all of that. And I tried to get back, and now it's just like, long time ago, not triggering me, you know.
So yeah, you made a choice to shut
need
down.
To go when, back.
Yeah. And I'd go back to even what they were about and all of those things.
Yeah.
Okay, if we pass back to Alex. Yeah.
I feel like you said it before, we're jumping out of our skins to try and get our point across. And because we're trying to do that so much, we're not open to actually listening to you.
Yeah, to be honest, up here today, what it feels like is you guys all have these things you want to cover, and I have a desire to cover some stuff that was possibly quite confronting. And every time I go down that track, I'd get, oh no, let's talk about this. Oh, you're jumping ahead. Oh, and I think, yep. I'm allowed to jump wherever I want. It's the group I'm running. But, yeah, I feel like... and maybe, like, we need to look at that, what book group is really about. For me, book group is about leading you guys through reflection and the lessons in the book, and hopefully fostering your own self-reflection through the homework and all. And I know heaps of you would like doing that generally. But if we, and I've also, in the start of this group, I realised, hey, I want to share all my revelations. And then I was like, no, that's not serving you. I want to, like, help you guys move through this book and reflect on what are the really beautiful lessons here. So I stopped doing that and I started asking you guys about it. But we need to be careful that there isn't some kind of addiction developed where we read the book and we go, oh, I realise this thing, I can't wait to share it in book group. Because that's not actually the purpose of the group either. It's not to share in each other's feelings or validate each other's realisations. That's not why I'm coming. I'm coming to, like, help maybe foster some reflection in you guys, also stretch you a little bit. I desire to stretch you a little bit. I feel like a lot of you have a lot of information at your fingertips, and do you really want to, like, stretch inside of yourself to understand it, to reflect for yourself, what does it mean when I put this in practice? You know, it's about love. Yeah, I've heard that a million times. What does that mean in your life? You know, what is it really trying to say? So it's lovely to quote the text also, but once we quote the text, we go, and what does that mean? You know, and I feel that's the beauty of this opportunity we have together. Yeah. Okay, if we pass back. Thanks, Alex.
This chapter brought for me so much difficulties to read. I was just sitting all afternoon and I just, even my dictionary couldn't translate the words. It was actually one of the most difficulties for me to read.
So what did you feel it was about then, Christy?
My connection with spirits in the moment, and it has been very blocked. Mm-hmm. I could see because something...
Can I put to you, yeah. It's not blocked, it's very open. And this is something I often say to myself as well. Yep, I can't do mediumship at the moment. I'm really blocked. Usually it's because I'm not blocked at all. I'm totally open to a whole bunch of spirits telling me I'm a crappy medium and it's all fake anyway and it's all ridiculous. And I'm actually, I have to recognise, I'm just open to spirits who really want to undermine my confidence. And I feel for a lot of you guys, this is a demonstration of how open you are to spirits, which is a good thing to recognise. Like we keep saying, more information is better than less. Okay, so we're struggling with this. It's all about how the spirit world relates with the earth, isn't it? And we're about to get into more chapters about that as well. So it's good if we tackle our resistances to this now, isn't it? Barbara?
Oh, thank you, Mary, for that. No reminding worries.
No worries.
I've been very shut down today, Mary, because it's not like me to sit here and say nothing.
I agree, Barbara.
And I've had to reflect on, what we learnt on the weekend. And as soon as I walked in here today, I was actually shut down and my head's pounding. And one of the biggest realisations I'm having and had on the weekend was that I'm more spirit influenced than I ever thought I was.
Yeah, yeah.
And because now I'm realising it, that's why I was shut down today.
Yeah. So that's a really good point you raise, Barb. And I think it's kind of why a lot of us are struggling. So what is the point we're missing? We've learnt some new truth. I'm really actually more influenced by spirits than I ever thought. And then we're going shut down. What is the opportunity we missed right there? Do you know what we're skipping over? It's an emotion. If you just pass behind you.
The fear of just how influenced we are.
Yeah.
I'm really getting to a very scared situation because I've realised I've just turned into my mother.
Okay.
And
so
the spirits are really hooking into that.
Yes, let's look at that because, okay, there's a fear, isn't there? There's a fear here. And you said two things. It's blocking me knowing just how spirit influenced I am. So you have a belief about that. What's your belief about knowing about more about how spirit influenced I am? Does anyone else share this belief? I have this fear. Ange? If we pass back, yep.
I can't change.
If I know how bad it is and I can't change, that's it forever and I just know I'm in hell and it's terrible. Yep. What else? Yep.
I've really been upset about this turning into my mother thing and I said to Geraldine on Sunday, AJ's answered two of my questions but he won't be able to answer this next one. And he just opened his mouth and did. Instead of me self-attacking and thinking, how am I ever going to get out? I'm much worse than I ever thought I was. How am I going to heal this? How can I be the best person I can be?
Yep.
Which I thought I'd done all my life, you know, going the opposite way from my parents, not to be like them. Mm-hmm. And then I've realised, you know, just recently since menopause, I'm becoming more bitter, more resentful. The apple has not fallen very far from the tree.
Well, it can't if we don't deal with what's in us, yeah.
And so then AJ said, you know, if you have faith in God and you have faith that you can change, it was that simple.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it was that simple because to me it was so complicated and dark.
But we're missing that already, aren't we? He just said it 3 days ago and we're missing it. So why? What's going on? One, we're afraid, aren't we? We don't want to feel it. And one of our fears is, I can't change. And that was the very thing, wasn't it, that he said. If you have faith that you as a person can change. Yeah.
What's been so beautiful is I'm having this automatic reaction coming up, which I think is spirit influence or just I have a lot of self-punishment going on. So the automatic reaction comes up as a fear that I can't change, what am I going to do about this? And then instantly the voice of reason comes in. You remember he said to use the voice of reason.
Yep.
That, you know, if I have faith in God, I can change. I've changed before.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. So that's good. But we're all, nevertheless, we're in a blocked book group, so let's keep talking about why we're blocked. Rochelle.
I think also there is a judgment on the group, like, oh, that person's spirit influence, that person's spirit influence. And I feel like it's been a negative thing where we judge each other uh-huh. around them, and I feel like that's been really unloving.
So there's judgment that's shutting us down, yeah?
Yeah. And the judgment on ourselves that, oh, my God, we are
I think that's being even bigger, yeah.
Yeah. So it'd be nice to have that lifted so we can just relate to each other openly without, oh, my God, you know. Like I
well,
feel like that's
given the where we are at the, in the group right today, we're all kind of going, well, yep, I'm shut down. This is really hard. This is probably spirit influence, isn't it? Mm. So,
but without having a judgment about it, like I feel like that's where I get stuck.
Exactly.
On myself. It's like I don't want to think that I've been influenced by spirits.
And can you see how closely judgment is related to the belief that we can't change? Mm. Like when we say, oh, you know, Yvonne's spirit influenced, you know, that's such a...
You're locking her in to
that. Well, but we don't have to be. It's our judgment of that state, yes. saying that she can't change from that, that makes Yvonne's the spirit influence one forever.
Yes.
Doesn't it?
Yes. And I think that relates to the whole church thing too, around you're persecuted to hell and you'll never get out of it. And
you can't change.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Once judgment happens, that's it. Yeah. Yeah. And also there is a very strong Christian belief that we're all sinners anyway. You know, you're never going to stop being a sinner. That's just the way you were created. Yeah, which is basically saying you can't change. Yeah. Laureen?
Just going on about seeing or having better rapport with the spirits, it's actually through the knowing and feeling the spirits that I attract that I realise more and more my own condition.
Yeah, it's this idea that more knowledge is better than less.
But it's not for me. It's like more knowledge is more scary and more terrifying and degrading.
And see, when you say to me, I know more of my own condition, I go, good news, and you go, bad news.
And it led me to reflect on why am I so determined to only relate to the darker spirits and never think or very rarely go to the celestial or higher spirits to want to have some connection to apart from my own spirit guides, you know?
Yeah.
It's just such a belief that I'm so inherently bad, that girdle of, you know, self-worth that we talked about.
Yeah.
And I start to see, yeah, I'm so fixed and firm in that belief. And it'll take quite a bit to constantly look at that.
Yeah, well, and even, can I say another word? Comfortable. I feel lots of us have gotten really comfortable just mucking around in the dark kind of stuff. It feels like a stretch to open myself to God and to raise my condition enough to talk to my guides, because we get comfortable with just the belief, yeah, I'm not really worth much. Yeah, I can just get addictions met. Like, it's just sort of a comfort sort of a place. It's not very happy, but it's comfortable. And I feel a lot of us get into that place where we just sort of wander around in the yuck. And this is why it's good to stretch, because it does take a stretch, like you said. It's going to take some effort on our behalves to grow.
And I looked at that and I said, why am I so comfortable in being so degraded? And it led me to, oh, I don't have to take responsibility. I don't have to make decisions. I don't have to learn
exactly.
to trust. I don't have to do all of these things that I've always said, no, I can't do that because of this. And it's so easy.
Yeah.
It's that choice of darkness that I choose because it's easy. Even though I complain about it, it's just, oh, well, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
But as soon as I go and say, why do I want that and why can't I choose another? I actually have to take effort you know, aim for it and want this change.
Absolutely. And that's a question that I want to put to you guys. Like, how many of you and how often do you think about the type of person you want to become? What's the kind of nature and character and soul qualities I want to develop? What do I want to be? Now, most of us don't even think about that because we're just wallowing around in how bad we are, or we feel it feels like a huge risk. I'm going to go for that, and what if I can't even do it? But that's what we need. We need to think, what kind of person am I now? Lord God, show me really the truth. And what kind of person do I want to become? Wow, that seems pretty amazing. But am I even up to that? And feel that. Feel that contrast. If you just pass back to Alwyn on that side, yeah.
In the Judas, Hans, whatever his name
Radix,
is.
Radix, yeah.
He said that the most predominant emotion in the hells was despair. And I think that really, you know, and that's that we can't change, and we certainly couldn't have any vision that we could actually be somebody wonderful.
That's
where everyone sits, I guess.
We're all sitting in this kind of comfortable despair of like, well, this is as good as it gets. It's good to think about these things and I'll try a bit to improve myself, but I don't actually want to think about how I really am and who I really want to become. And if you think about it, unless we think about both those two things, we're not going to shift very far, are we? It's going to be a small margin. And based on our comfort zone. Remember we talked about here a while back about our comfort zone in terms of temperature, in terms of emotions, and it will go from here to here, this happy, this sad. And really we need to be like willing to be super duper happy and really gut-wrenchingly sad and surrender to it. Barbara and Yvonne on this side.
Mary, for me it's a bit more than that. Laziness comes into it for me as well, not only in my comfort zone, but I always visualise myself as this person that I'd like to be, that I believe that God created me to be, but it's a laziness of not wanting to do the yards to get there sometimes.
And what's that about, do you reckon, Barbara? What makes you lazy? Because there's a lot under laziness.
There is, isn't there? Because in anything else, most things in my life, I am not lazy.
No, not at all.
So
what's your investment in laziness?
In this?
Yes. There, you have an investment. Like, yes, I'll stay lazy on this issue. What is it?
Is it to allow others to go before me? No? Okay. That's a furphy. It's a cop-out. Laziness is a cop-out.
It's a cop-out. What emotion do you get to avoid?
Oh, just about every emotion, don't you?
You do, but there's a few you really want to avoid.
Okay. You might have to tell me, Mary.
Well, there's issues around your worth. Am I good enough to do this? Can I really do this? Faith in your own capacity to change, and dominantly just fear. Fear of what I'm going to have to, if, like, honestly, and trust me, I'm walking this like totally. when you look at, like, I'm not speaking for a person at the destination, I'm looking at the path ahead going, holy shit. Sorry to be crude, but that's really what it is. When you look at the person you want to become, when you really examine that person and then you examine who you are right now, you go, oh, if I'm going to be that, that means I have to let go of this thing. I'm going to have to face that fear. I'm going to have to receive that truth. I can't get away with things in this way. I really know that that's not serving me in my relationship with God. That means letting that go. I'm really petrified of this person and I'm going to have to confront that fear, release it and forgive and love them. You know, and I can't keep making excuses if I really want to be this person. And it is pretty scary.
And that's where I've got to.
Well, if we want to get to that person, we're going to have to get to that point and go, well, the only way forward is to feel this fear. Yeah. No worries. If you go behind you,
And then we'll go back to Karina after that.
Mary, I loved that chapter. Was it 9? Or was
the
it
jealousy?
Ten, the short chapter.
Yep.
And I thought, gee, there's nothing much of interest in this chapter. And I couldn't believe that you somehow got all of that arrogance versus humility out of it. And I had so much trouble not leaving my body.
Yeah.
And then I fled home as soon as I could. And I got home and I somehow smashed a bottle of oil. And then I turned around and the clock fell onto the floor and that glass smashed. And then I turned around and a glass smashed.
Wow.
And I just flipped out. I knew I was flipping out in fear.
Yeah.
But it was that simple. I wasn't willing to feel humble. I was hanging on to the arrogance. And I think that laziness is about that too. It's about not willing to be humble.
Well, all of this really is about not willing to be humble, hey? When we're in despair, it's almost a place of complete hopelessness, isn't it? And we don't want to actually grieve, so we just choose the anger of just there is no hope. Yeah, and that's a complete lack of humility. When we're lazy as well, yeah, yeah, yeah. If we go back to Karina...
It's in response to your question about what's going on for us today.
Yeah.
And I want to apologise for how I was before. And what's happened, I think, is that I've had this desire all week to do the homework, and I've just watched the spirit influence of just distraction, distraction, distraction. And it's been almost despair that I keep sabotaging myself. So I arrived here feeling shame and guilt that I haven't lived up to my expectation with the homework. And then rather than have the humility to feel that, I tried to control things.
Yeah, and you know, I felt there was quite a heavy presence for a while of some spirits wanting to take me away from the discussion about rapport. And it was literally like people weren't hearing what I was saying. And I don't mind you guys, as you know, adding your revelations or your questions as you go. But there was a point there where it was like I couldn't even reach you through the stuff. Yeah, that was... And so I feel it's a very good demonstration, Karina, of when we come, we're not humble, it leaves a huge opening, and then spirits can just dictate the way we even interact in the group. So I felt it was less your desire to control and more some people with you desiring to control, but because you weren't really connected to yourself, you became the vehicle for that. And I agree there's some feelings of a desire to control within you, and that also adds to the rapport. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, who else had their hand up? If we go to Moni over here, and Renee, did you have your hand up? Yep. So we'll go to Mon first, yeah.
I just felt today that you were, rather than coming and already knowing our homework, you were testing us, like trying to lift us. I feel like asking hard questions of ourselves. And I found that really challenging, and I felt really stupid and my self-worth. And I feel like just to feel that is really great.
It is my desire to challenge you guys, you know, especially when I feel there's kind of a, there's sort of a feeling of like, yeah, yeah, we go along, it's really nice, and we just sort of say a few things about the chapter, and I feel when we're losing sight of this is like, this can have an impact in our lives, what are our four questions each week, what are the truths I learn, how does it apply to me, how have I acted on these things, then I do challenge you guys more about that. But please know, and at the risk of the desire to defend myself, when I ask these questions, I'm being challenging. Like sometimes they're questions that have really challenged me in the past. I don't expect that you must know or you're a bad student. I've stood up here and gone, yeah, I don't know the answer to that question either. It's a really good question. Like, I'm going to have to think about that, pray about that, feel about that. So I don't feel like just because we're in this mode of asking a lot of questions that you need to feel like I've got to have the answers. Of course, if it brings that up for you, that's, yeah, yeah.
Just stupid.
Yeah, and that's just a grief from your childhood, hey? Yeah. Okay, Renee.
Mary, I was just enjoying your guidance through the book club, and I was very excited actually because I read the chapter and like there was a lot I didn't understand, and lots, and there were paragraphs I did, and I was really excited. I got bits, and I was like, "Yay!" And I felt fear coming here, but I actually just wanted to be still and quiet and just listen. And every time you were guiding us through to that area of rapport, I was getting excited, going, "Yeah, yeah, 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 yeah!" And then it was like, "Yeah, we didn't quite get to the pinnacle of it, but
we didn't really nail it, did we?"
No, but the feeling is that, I'm feeling joy that we're sort of going into this area.
Yeah.
So
that's good. I feel that what I was going to discuss with you guys about rapport is really kind of crucial, obviously, because there's a lot of resistance to it. And so maybe we need to set some homework around rapport and revisit next week. What do you think? Yeah. Renee?
I just say it just feels like spiritual food somewhere. It's like... yeah. For my soul, you know, and also the fact that forget that.
Okay, all right, yeah, all right. Okay. Just looking at what I was thinking to cover here. I wanted to talk to you guys about how our relationships are often based around common beliefs. So perhaps if you consider the relationships in your life, look at what beliefs you have in common with the people in relationships. Because of course this will be applicable for the spirits around you also, won't it? If you consider your physical relationships, that you're going to learn about yourself and your own condition. And if you're in a partner-based relationship, or if you have been, consider what error-based beliefs and common physical interests might be bringing you together. Consider what error-based beliefs and common physical interests. By this I mean like activities, like cycling, bushwalking. A lot of people come together because they share a common interest in something, don't they? So to look at that aspect of your partnership relationship and then consider what kind of love-based beliefs might be there in the relationship also. Do you want a lot of homework? Because I can think of two more questions. Yeah, yeah. Karen, if we just pass the mic to Karen before I say the next one.
I'm sorry, could I have an example of a love-based belief?
Yeah, good question, good question. All right, so before we talked about Steve and Sherry and the common error-based belief in both of them has been, at least, that a woman should be able to talk as much, she should be heard under all circumstances, and it's not important for the man to be heard. So that's an error-based belief that they both carried, isn't it? So what would be a love-based belief in a relationship then? Deirdre?
That you're both equal. Or
yeah,
that you both are entitled to a point of view, or you're both entitled to be heard.
Yeah, yeah. Or, yeah, and can we say perhaps, for example, that each of us, if we really have this emotional belief in the relationship, it's going to be pretty powerful. Each of us has their own will to exercise in whatever way they want. That's a love-based belief, isn't it? Each of us has a personality that if we love the other person, we'll encourage them to explore their desires and personality. So if both people in the relationship have the belief, my partner is just as important as me,
And it's really important to me that they are able to explore their passions and desires just as much as it's important to me. That's a love-based belief. Okay? All right, second set of questions is around the idea that our beliefs can make us blind. So if you do a reflective exercise, look back on your life and see where you have lived in error, either through how you've treated other people, how you've perceived love to be in your relationship. So how your beliefs in those situations made you blind. And if those beliefs have changed in order for you to see the error now. So consider the difference. Then ask your guides to help show you areas in your life where your beliefs are still keeping you blind. Third set of questions. That last section. What did I say? I was thinking about the next set. The first one was consider how your beliefs in the past have kept you blind to errors, and now you can see your beliefs have changed. Consider the two beliefs that have changed for you to now see you were in error in the past. Then ask your guides and God to help you see areas in your life now where your beliefs are still keeping you blind. Your false beliefs are keeping you blind to certain truths. So ask to be shown new truth, basically, about your belief systems. This is hopeless because I'm not going to remember them either. I'm not even writing them down. I think I know them. Yeah. Cool. Okay, third exercise has to be about spirits because everyone's blocked them. Lorleen, what was the activity you did? You wrote down the beliefs. Is there a mic on that side? If we could just have it to Lorleen.
I wrote down why I didn't want to see and believe about spirits.
Yeah. Yeah, so if we can do that exercise, why don't I want to achieve more communication with spirits? Sorry? With spirits. Why don't you? Why don't you want more? Why do you want less? No, I think it's good to have more. Can you guys see that because everyone got shut down because we don't? We're like, I don't want to communicate with you, I'll just do what you say. Yeah. Can you see that distinction? I don't want to have awareness. Say awareness then. Why don't I want to have awareness of the spirits around me? Be they in higher or lower condition than me. So why don't I want to have awareness of spirits around me? And related to that is what are my fears about spirits? You know, that should lead you to that anyway, but... And something that's really handy that I do is I write down on one side of the page, what are my beliefs about spirits? On the other side, what is God's truth about spirits? Whatever issue, you can do that for. That's something I learned from Jesus, and it's really confronting. It's really confronting when you do the whole side of false beliefs and you go, I don't want to write it in the other one. I want to hold on to that one. I don't want to write the truth. But a lot of you know, at least intellectually, God's truth about the spirit world and what governs the spirit world. So it's really handy to write it in the other column because it confronts your error directly. Yeah. Okay, that's a lot of homework. So next week, let's see how we go discussing the homework, and we might move on to the start on chapter 13. Depending on how we go with the homework, okay? I feel that if a lot of you do the homework, it'll help you move through the resistance anyway, so we might not need much time discussing it. But we pretty much covered everything in the chapter in terms of the story, didn't we? So we're ready to move on to chapter 13. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Thank you.